We've seen the wrath of God, but it's not over. Today is the battle royale. Not the fight of the century. Not the fight of the millennium. The fight of the ages. The greatest fight men will ever witness. Revelation for Life is coming at you with the Battle of Armageddon. I'm sure we've all heard the word Armageddon before. We're talking about the Battle of Armageddon, but we only call it that because of the place it's going to happen. What do we know about the venue for this battle royale? Revelation 16 says in verse 12, "And the sixth angel poured out his vial upon the great river Euphrates, and the water thereof was dried up, that the way of the kings of the east might be prepared. And I saw three unclean spirits," this is verse 13, "like frogs, come out of the mouth of the dragon, and out of the mouth of the beast, and out of the mouth of the false prophet." Verse 14, "For they are the spirits of devils, working miracles, which go forth unto the kings of the earth and of the whole world to gather them to the battle of that great day of God Almighty." Verse 16, "And he gathered them together into a place called in the Hebrew tongue Armageddon." During the last round of plagues sent to the earth, the Euphrates River is dried up, but this is so the rulers of the earth can reach a place called Armageddon in the Hebrew language. You can postulate where this place could be, but I want to get to the fight. We know the venue. Let's look at the challenger. Revelation 19 from verse 11 to 13 says, "And I saw heaven open, and behold a white horse. And he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he doth judge and make war. His eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns, and he had a name written that no man knew but himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God." The challenger is Jesus Christ himself. He is called the Word of God. Jesus is first introduced to us by this title in John chapter 1. Verse 1 says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." Verse 14 says, "And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth." There's no mistaking the identity of this challenger. He's called the Word, and that will be important a little later. But I want to point out that although he is the challenger, he's also the undisputed champion, because he has never been defeated. And he's not alone. He's got some allies backing him up. Revelation 19:14 says, "And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean." Who are these armies? Could they be angels? Well, it's possible, but angels ready for battle are usually referred to as the hosts of heaven, and they have wings. They don't usually ride horses. Could these armies be something more? Well, let's look at what was happening in heaven directly before the heavens opened to reveal Jesus and his armies. Revelation 19 from verse 6 to 8 says, "And I heard, as it were, the voice of a great multitude, and as the voice of many waters, and as the voice of mighty thundering, saying, Alleluia, for the Lord God omnipotent reigneth. Let us be glad and rejoice, and give honor to him, for the marriage of the Lamb is come, and his wife hath made herself ready, and to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white, for the fine linen is the righteousness of saints." The saints of God are described arrayed in the same clean and white linen as the armies who follow Christ out of heaven. Now, there's an expectation that at some point, Christ is going to pull his church out of the earth. We can't definitively say at what point in the narrative that happens, but the school of thought is that the raptured saints follow Christ as his armies when he returns to the earth to wage war. Now, this is seemingly ratified by verse 14's wording, "the armies that were in heaven," which would imply that these writers are not natives of heaven, but were only there for a time. So, the saints are described in the same garments as these armies, but there's more evidence to support this idea. Revelation 17 gives a sneak peek of the Battle of Armageddon when it speaks of the kings of the earth. Verse 14 says, "These shall make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb shall overcome them, for he is Lord of lords and King of kings, and they that are with him are called and chosen and faithful." The verse said that they that are with him are called, chosen, and faithful. These are all adjectives used to describe God's people, the saints, especially called and chosen. I've never heard angels referred to as called and chosen, only the saints of God. Now, I don't know about you, but I need to be in that army. I want a first-hand view of this battle royale from behind the challenger. Now, as I said before, I really want to get to this fight, but I can't do that before you understand something very important to our overarching story narrative. This is the event the Jews expected the first time Jesus came. Acts 1:6 says, "When they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom of Israel?" The Jews were waiting on a Messiah to physically break the hold of their oppressors and restore the kingdom. However, the first time Jesus came, he fought a spiritual battle so that we could enter the kingdom spiritually before he brought it physically to the earth. The Jews did not accept him because they expected the events of the second coming at the first coming. John 1 from verse 10 to 11 says, "He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. He came unto his own, and his own received him not." But this time, the Jews will accept Jesus as their king. Romans 11:25 says, "For I would not, brethren, that ye should be ignorant of this mystery, lest ye should be wise in your own conceits, that blindness in part is happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles come in." The Jews were blinded from seeing Jesus as the true Messiah only until the fullness of the Gentiles, or non-Jews, had come in. The fullness of the Gentiles has come in by this time, because as we've been following in our narrative, there has been no repentance for a while now. We looked at Revelation 9 from verse 20 to 21, Revelation 11 verses 3, 5, and 6, Revelation 16 verses 9, 11, and 21. These verses all say the same thing. Men did not repent. There's no one else accepting Christ at this point in the narrative, so the fullness of the Gentiles has come in. All the people that were going to accept Christ have done so, and the Jews are now going to have their eyes open, and Christ will be king of Israel physically. But first, he must fight. The first time he came as a lamb to be sacrificed. But this time, it's not the lamb who's coming. Oh no, it's the king. The conquering lion of the tribe of Judah. Revelation 19 verses 15 and 16 say, "And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron. And he treadeth the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. And he hath on his vesture and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords." Revelation 19 from verse 17 to 19 says, "And I saw an angel standing in the sun, and he cried with a loud voice, saying to all the fowls that fly in the midst of heaven, come and gather yourselves together unto the supper of the great God, that ye may eat the flesh of kings, and the flesh of captains, and the flesh of mighty men, and the flesh of horses, and of them that sit on them, and the flesh of all men, both free and bond, both small and great. And I saw the beast, and the kings of the earth, and their armies gathered together to make war against him that sat on the horse, and against his army." The stage is set. Kings of the earth versus the King of Kings. Remember, back in episode 5, I said that the Antichrist and the false prophet were merely secondary characters. I said they wouldn't last till the end of the narrative. And they don't. Actually, they're the first to be taken out. Revelation 19, 20 says, "And the beast was taken, and with him the false prophet that wrought miracles before him, with which he deceived them that had received the mark of the beast, and them that worshipped his image. These both were cast alive into a lake of fire, burning with brimstone." Well, if the characters the kings of the earth were following have already been dispatched, things aren't looking too good for the kings. Revelation 19:21 says, "And the remnant were slain with the sword of him that sat upon the horse, which sword proceeded out of his mouth, and all the fowls were filled with their flesh." You can't fight against the word of God. John described it as a sword coming out of the mouth of Jesus and slaying all the enemies. This is not a literal sword, but the Bible describes the Word of God as the sword of the Spirit. When God speaks, nothing can stand up to that Word. This is the God that said, "Let there be light," and there was light. This is the God that cursed the fig tree and it dried up from the roots by the next day. How do you fight against someone whose Word is that powerful? You can't. Jesus won't have to lift a finger in this battle. He just has to declare a thing and it will be so. Based on this text, the armies that were in heaven never get to enter the battle because he decimates the field effortlessly and the birds finish off the carcasses. I don't know about you, but I want to be on the winning side of this inevitable battle. And and I want to be a partaker in what comes next. The battle is fought and won, but the story isn't finished yet. What happens to the dragon? What is the new kingdom Christ is establishing on the earth? Are all the unbelievers gone? Get the answers to all these questions in our next episode. But until then, this is Revelation for Life.